Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Medieval Philosophy, A Beginner's Guide, written by Sharon M Kaye and read by Paul English. Preface and Acknowledgments. Welcome to Medieval Philosophy, A Beginner's Guide. It grows from 10 years of experience teaching an undergraduate medieval philosophy course. I developed this course with the conviction that the only way to appreciate the unique contribution of the Middle Ages is to read what the authors themselves actually wrote. This presents an immediate problem, however, because medieval writings are not accessible to the beginner. I have therefore carefully excerpted, translated, and edited all of the classic passages to be discussed in this book. In so doing, I hope to have preserved their central insights while eliminating unnecessary complications. This book aims to present all the best ideas of the Middle Ages in a way that will enable you, the modern reader, to make a personal assessment of them. Many aspects of medieval philosophy are still with us, living in our minds and in our hearts. We investigate their origin in order to understand ourselves better. I truly enjoyed writing this book. I would like to thank my students over the years for showing me which ideas are still important and why. I am grateful to John Carroll University for providing a generous research leave during the spring of 2006, when I conceived this project. My thanks go also to Martin Tweedale, Professor Emeritus at the University of Alberta, as well as Marsha Fillion and Mike Hartley at One World for their helpful suggestions and encouragement. Finally, I would like to dedicate this book to my husband, Tris. Quos amor verus tenuit tenebit. Sharon Kaye. Introduction. The medieval period, also known as the Middle Ages, spans roughly the years AD 400 to 1400. Since the printing press was not invented until 1440, intellectual culture was very different then from what we are used to today. Books were written and copied by hand on treated animal skins, making them extremely valuable and rare. It's hard to believe such a primitive society could possibly have anything to say to us in the 21st century. Although we are far ahead of the medievals when it comes to technology, we aren't so far ahead when it comes to philosophy. Many of the philosophical ideas first proposed in the Middle Ages are still current among us. During the years between AD 400 and 1400, the Catholic Church came to dominate all of Europe. The main priority of those few who were fortunate enough to be educated was to try to make sense of religious doctrine and to pass it on to the next generation. Hence, medieval philosophy is primarily concerned with deep questions raised by the existence of God. The ideas medieval philosophers developed to answer these questions have endured. Most people around the world today still believe in God. It is not surprising to find, therefore, that medieval discussions of the questions that the existence of God raises remain interesting and useful. We trace the beginning of the Middle Ages to the year AD 400 because this date marks the end of the Roman Empire. The Roman Empire was an advanced civilization established in the 3rd century BC with a complex system of laws, infrastructure, and culture. At the height of its glory, it stretched across Europe, all the way from Britain to Asia Minor. Its collapse at the beginning of the 5th century led to several hundred years of chaos, including ongoing wars, famines, and plagues. The period from around 550 to around 1050 is often referred to as the Dark Ages, because it allowed for only a very limited amount of learning and development. Few people could even read or write. The Roman language, Latin, slowly transformed into the various Romance languages we know today: French, Portuguese, Spanish, Italian. One of the most important features of the Roman Empire, which helped to make it so successful for so many years, was its assimilation of the Greek Golden Age. Just as the greatest Roman buildings were inspired by Greek architecture, the greatest Roman ideas were inspired by Greek philosophers. This pattern did not change after the fall of the Roman Empire. On the contrary, the scarcity of books and widespread fear of new ideas reinforced it. Medieval philosophers were deeply dependent on the works of the two greatest philosophers of ancient Greece, namely Plato and Aristotle. Early on, they had no direct access to the works of Plato and Aristotle because they could not read Greek and there were no translations. Nevertheless, they learned about Plato and Aristotle indirectly, and as time went on, they gained access to translations. Because medieval philosophy lasted a millennium and spanned the many different cultures of Europe, it is complex and worthy of detailed, in-depth study. Nevertheless, every study must begin somewhere, and at the beginning it is helpful to have a simple framework for understanding the big picture. Plato and Aristotle provide us with this framework. Because they advocated opposing philosophies, they established two poles between which medieval authors can be located. In this book, we will focus primarily on the three major medieval philosophers, Augustine, Thomas Aquinas, and William of Ockham. Plato's approach is paramount in the early Middle Ages, as Augustine shows in his Christian Neoplatonism. By the High Middle Ages, we see a shift to moderate Aristotelianism, as exemplified in the work of Aquinas. Ockham serves primarily as a critic of both Neoplatonism and moderate Aristotelianism, pushing towards an extreme interpretation of Aristotle. Intervening discussions of Boethius, Anselm, Abelard, Averroes, and Scotus, inter alia, will fill out our picture of the medieval period as a whole. Scholasticism, circa 1100 to 1500. Even during the darkest part of the medieval period, the Catholic Church needed schools for educating priests. Over time, these schools gave rise to the university system we know today. The first universities, established around 1200, offered only three graduate degrees: medicine, law, or theology. Philosophy thrived within the faculty of theology. The church was concerned to show how religious faith could be reconciled with scientific reasoning. It therefore required theology students to examine statements from religion and science that appeared to conflict, and to show how the conflict could be resolved. The 12th century theologian Peter Lombard collected these statements into a book and called it The Sentences. Thereafter, every theology student was required to write a commentary on the sentences. This involved very detailed logical analysis and argumentation. The resulting dialectical method of learning came to be known as scholasticism. To Renaissance thinkers who were trying to free themselves from the domination of religion, the scholastics seemed overly bookwormish. The term scholastic has retained this negative connotation today. This book presents all the most compelling ideas of the medieval philosophers, along with their method for thinking about them. We'll investigate intriguing questions that have probably occurred to you at one time or another, such as the following: Does God exist outside of time? How does God know the future? Is it possible to prove God exists? Why do bad things happen to good people? Am I free? Why be moral? Medieval philosophers developed classic answers to these questions that are still among the very best available. In addition to the answers themselves, medieval philosophers also developed a powerful method for thinking about such questions, namely, logic. Stylistically, the most distinctive thing about medieval philosophy is its dense argumentation. Authors used recognizable logical patterns to prove their points and to challenge their opponents' theories. In true medieval style, we will apply this rigor throughout our study. Chapter 1. The Ancient Legacy. The unexamined life is not worth living. Socrates. Due to their divergent philosophies, Plato and Aristotle launched opposing ways of thinking about the world that were at odds throughout the Middle Ages. Although some philosophers maintained that the ideas of the two great ancient philosophers could ultimately be harmonized, there was no widespread agreement about how this could be accomplished. The conflict between Plato and Aristotle actually proved to be very fruitful, however, because it pushed each side to make the best arguments possible. Argumentation is the way philosophy progresses, and logic is the backbone of argumentation. In order to understand what our medieval authors were trying to accomplish, we will need to be able to dissect the structure of their reasoning. We therefore begin this chapter with a survey of the basic principles of logic that Plato, Aristotle, and their successors bequeathed to the Middle Ages. The Socratic Method. The word logic comes from the Greek word logos, meaning reason. We use the same word at the end of our scientific disciplines, such as biology and psychology, to mean the systematic study of. Logic is systematic study. It stipulates the rules of thought itself. Logic started in ancient Greece and became a sophisticated tool in the hands of medieval philosophers. Socrates, circa 470 to 399 BC. Socrates is known as the founder of Western philosophy. Although Socrates was a sculptor by trade, he preferred to spend his time hanging around the public square in Athens and engaging passers-by in conversation. For example, Socrates might try to provoke a lawyer into a debate about the nature of justice. Because he was good at arguing and had a lot of interesting ideas, Socrates became known as a philosopher, from the Greek words for love of wisdom. He attracted a following of fans. Socrates also made a lot of enemies, however, by questioning authority and challenging the status quo. Eventually, he was tried, convicted, and executed for impiety and corrupting the youth. Socrates is the first on record to develop and employ a method of systematic study. It is called the elenchus, meaning cross-examination. Although Socrates did not write any books, his student Plato wrote many books about him. Appropriately enough, the elenchus first appears in a work called The Apology, in which Plato describes a court trial at which Socrates had to defend his own reputation. During the trial, Socrates announces that God revealed to him that he is the wisest among men. Admitting that he himself did not at first believe the revelation, he proceeds to show how and in what sense he learned it to be true. My defense. After long consideration, I finally thought of a method of testing the question. I reflected that if I could find someone wiser than myself, then I might go to God with a refutation in my hand. I would say to God, "You said that I was the wisest, but here is someone who is wiser than I am." Accordingly, I went to a man who had a reputation for wisdom, and the result was as follows. When I began to talk with him, it became evident that his supposed wisdom consisted in the fact that he thought himself to be wise. When I tried to explain that thinking you are wise is not the same as being wise, he grew to hate me. So I left him, saying to myself as I went away, "Well, even though neither of us is wise, I'm better off than he is, for he claims to know things that he doesn't really know, whereas I neither know nor think that I know. In this way, I seem to have a slight advantage over him." Then I went to another man who had even higher philosophical pretensions, and my conclusion was exactly the same. I made another enemy of him, and of many others besides him, as I went from one to another searching for a wise man. The truth I learned, O people of Athens, is this. Only God is wise. God's revelation to me was meant to be humbling. He was using me as an illustration, as if to say, the wisest person is the one who, like Socrates, knows that his wisdom is in truth worth nothing. As demonstrated in this passage, the elenchus is a powerful way to refute your opponent. It is therefore useful, not just in court, but in any philosophical debate. We can appreciate the structure of the argument more clearly if we rewrite it in schematic form as follows. To prove, Socrates is the wisest person. 1. Suppose Socrates is not the wisest person. 2. If Socrates is not the wisest person, then other people must be wiser. 3. All the other people claim to know things they don't really know. 4. It would be absurd for a wise person to claim to know things he or she doesn't really know. 5. Therefore, Socrates is the wisest person. Notice that if you accept steps 1 through 4, then you can't deny step 5. In the Middle Ages, this method of argumentation came to be called reductio ad absurdum, which is Latin for reduction to an absurdity. It is still widely used today. The goal is not to show that your opponent is silly or laughable, but rather to show that his view implies something that cannot possibly be true. In philosophy, the word absurdity refers to an impossibility or contradiction. Validity. Although Socrates typically preferred to use the elenchus method in his arguments, Plato's student Aristotle realized that there are a number of other equally compelling ways to make one's case. In the following passage from a work called Prior Analytics, Aristotle develops a general criterion for classifying and evaluating different kinds of arguments. Logic Basics. A
premise. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.